changing, so I will dance through the day, I will sing through the night, 'cause you are who you say you are. I will dance through the day, I will sing through the night, 'cause you are who you say you
We'd like to point out we do have seating upstairs for anyone available. If you can't find a seat down here, there is seating available in the balcony. There's overflow in the chapel as well. So.
Woo. Welcome, everyone. Welcome, everyone. Hello. It looks like a party to me. Y'all ready to worship? We're grateful for Papa Don. It's going to be a great morning, and so I can't think of anything better to start with than this song to sort of reel us in and remind us of what this whole thing's all about. Here we go.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart, I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart.
And I heard the church sing,
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. The King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. All I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. It's all about you. It's all about you. Sing it again. It's all about you. It's all about you. Always has been and always will. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. We enter your gates with thanksgiving and praise. And Lord, we will never forget. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. And thought of me above. Amen. Still a way maker, isn't he? Here we go.
You are here, you're moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. And I heard heard the church sing, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You never stop working. Even when I can see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I can see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. Hey, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Oh, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God.
That is who you are.
Waymaker, miracle work. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
I know the night won't last.
I know the night
won't last. Your word will come to pass. I will see your praise again.
Jesus. This is how I fight my battles. 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 I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. You believe that? It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
This is how I fight my battles. 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 It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight. Is an awesome God, he reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God, oh yeah. Our God is an awesome God, he reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God, sing it out. Our God is an awesome God.
So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you, all the great are you, Lord. It's your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out.
We pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs.
Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Good morning. You may be seated. If you did not get the bread and the cup when you got here this morning, we have some here. If you'll raise your hand, people will bring them to you. My name is Phil Kendrick. I'm one of the elders here at Belmont Church. Glad to have the family together this morning. I'm going to be sharing with you a revelation from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Galatians 1, verses 11 and 12. This is Paul saying this. I want you to know, brothers, that the gospel I preached is not something that man made up. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. There are two places in the 13 letters from Paul where he directly quotes from the Lord Jesus. If you don't believe me, you can check me out. If you got a red letter Bible, you can go through and in 2 minutes, you can weed it out. One of them is in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, on the heels of when Paul was taken to the third heaven. And then he says, to keep me from becoming conceited because of these surpassingly great revelations, he was given a thorn in the flesh, and he asked the Lord 3 times to remove it. And the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. One other time, you'll see the red letters of Jesus in Paul's writings, and that's in 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Passion says, I've handed down to you what came to me by direct revelation from the Lord himself. The Corinthians had not been doing the Lord's Supper well. They were gorging themselves. They were getting drunk. And Paul comes to them and says, this is the way you do it. I'm passing on to you what the Lord Jesus himself told me about this. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, one small digression. When the Lord Jesus was giving this revelation to Paul, did Jesus say, on the night I was betrayed, this is what happened? Or did the Holy Spirit nudge Paul to say, on the night the Lord was betrayed, this is what he said? Either way, it's the word of God. But if you think that Jesus revealed to Paul, he identified that night by the night I was betrayed, the one who is called faithful and true says, on the night I was betrayed, this is what happened. Took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. It's similar to the account in the Gospel of Luke. The Corinthians didn't have the Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke was written after Paul wrote the letter to the Corinthians. I don't know what sort of passed down tradition they had, but Paul wants to make it clear to them, the Lord Jesus told me this. This is my body. Whenever you take it, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. The enemy seeks to distract us. Sometimes even during communion, our thoughts drift elsewhere. That's not the way it should be. The words of Jesus are momentous as always, but they're simple. Remember me when you do this. Remember the faithful Jesus. Remember the forgiving Jesus, the loving Jesus, the crucified Jesus, the risen Jesus, the only begotten. Let's remember him. And when we take the bread and drink the cup, we are proclaiming his death until he comes. Again, the Passion says, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are retelling the story, proclaiming our Lord's death until he comes. So, from Jesus, here are our instructions. Remember Jesus. And at the same time, family, we are retelling the story. We are proclaiming until his return the death of Jesus. You may take the bread and the cup.
Ladies in the house, sing this first verse. 3, 4.
Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you and praise you. We say the answer to that question is yes, you are worthy. Worthy to receive all glory and honor and praise and dominion. And so we come this morning joining with the angels in heaven around your throne proclaiming the goodness of the Lord. Let's give him a shout. Amen. You're worthy, Lord. Worthy to receive all glory and honor and praise. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name. Amen. You may be seated. Michael, thank you. Trey, team, this is fabulous. What a great way to start this morning. Amen. We're going to continue with worship this morning and taking our offerings, and we have several ways to do it. You can do a basket. You can text. You can email it. You can do Pony Express. Well, we have several ways if you want to contribute. We invite you to do that. And, you know, Wednesday evening we were reflecting over some things that God had taught us over the past 50 years. And one of the things that Don talked about was just generosity and why that is such an important thing. So if you would put that scripture up that is found in Luke, and if you would read this with me, give and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap, for with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. The truth of the Word of God. So Lord, we come today saying we want to be those kind of people. We want to give and know that your promises are true. May we be generous in all occasions and for all things, and we give you glory in Jesus, and amen. So our monies here go for regular, and we also have local outreach and missions, and so just be aware of that, that those things are significant for us here at Belmont. Well, welcome to Belmont. My name is Jim Davis. I'm like Phil. I'm one of the elders here at Belmont. And we are just delighted you're with us this morning. There's a card in the seat back in front of you called our check-in card. And if you'd like to fill that out, we'd love to know that you were here. We actually have a gift at the welcome desk for you. And after the assembly today, as Rachel would say, we're going to have some nibbles out in the lobby. And Don's going to stick around and greet people. And there's also a journal out there for you to write any memorials or memories of things of Don or being at Belmont. And so we encourage you to do that. So we're going to proceed on and let our kids go to classes right now. We'll take 3 or 4 minutes. And so get up, greet each other. There's surely somebody here that you need to greet. And then we'll come back with Don.
There it is.
I know he's getting ready to go up front, but I'm going to get a hug afterwards. I may never get a chance afterwards.
Oh, no.
You can help me up.
Well, where'd my Bible go? It's over here somewhere.
Yeah.
All right. If we can call you back in, that'd be great. Enough of this fellowshipping. Again, thank you all so much for being here. Can you imagine what heaven's going to be like? We're going to have so much fun checking in with each other and telling stories, and some true, some untrue, but we'll have a good time doing it. So, well, I want to introduce Mick Antonitis, who's our pastor emeritus from Missions and also an elder here, and we've got a special presentation he wants to do this morning.
So, Don, on this Jubilee Sunday of celebrating 50 years of you having you in our lives, we say thank you. We love you.
Oh, man. Let me hug you further.
I may give you another chance to do that. From one man, God made every nation on earth, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the times and the places where they were going to live. He did this so that they would seek him and reach out for him and find him, though he's not far from each one of us. This is God's great redemptive epic in space and time and in history. And then in Psalm 87, we read about the register of the peoples, all nations coming into their worship of our great God and Savior. When that happens, God himself is writing the names of those nations in this book called the Register of the Peoples. And when that register closes at some time in redemptive history, we're going to be living in the middle of that beautiful and awesome Revelation chapter 7 moment of eternity, when a massive number of people from every nation, tribe, tongue, and people will be thunderously exalting Jesus as the divine Lamb of God. That day is coming. Israel's name is going to be at the top of the list in that register of the peoples. For God chose Israel to first receive his truth and love, and to protect and to defend it, and to share his truth and love with all nations as a blessing to every nation, Genesis 12. God brings salvation to Israel and the nations through Yeshua HaMashiach, through Jesus the Messiah. And in Isaiah chapter 49, God says this to Israel: not only do you have my beautiful and powerful light of salvation for your own tribes, but you, Israel, are also a light. You are a light to all the other nations. Salvation for Israel and for the nations, God's sovereign plan. Romans 11 clearly says that God's prophetic call on Israel has not changed, that one day all of Israel will be saved, and that the redeemed of the nations on that day will stream to Israel to worship God together, Jeremiah 3. When Papa Don stepped aside from his remarkable and memorable role as our senior pastor 25 years ago, it was to take on another kingdom role, the founding and leading of Caleb Company, now called Caleb Global, in the laying on of his hands and in the devoting of his life to this prophetic role of Israel and the nations. And he has embraced it as vigorously as a 20-year-old on his first job. Now, perhaps that does not surprise you. Belmont Church has been absolutely blessed to walk with you, Papa Don, and Caleb, Todd, for these last 25 years. We have eagerly walked in support and in partnership with you over these years. We were emphatic in wanting to be able to have you as one of our Faith Promise missionaries. Thank you, Don, for serving so extraordinarily well again. Our cups this morning are overflowing in gratitude for your life, Don. Thank you for impacting us so incredibly for those 25 years as our senior pastor, our extraordinary teacher, and our loving shepherd. Thank you for 25 more years as a prophetic and apostolic missionary to Israel and to the nations. And thank you for 50 years as our spiritual father, our older brother, our friend, and our apostle. It has been a priceless privilege and an honor for us, Don, to walk in these ways with you and to be blessed by you. We love you, Don, to the praise of God's glory. Now, I have one final piece to bring to us as a body, as the family of God, as we represent multiple congregations today. This morning, we want to announce that after consultation with Papa Don and prayer, with great joy, the elders have given a special gift from our endowment fund to Caleb Global in honor of Papa Don for Israel and the nations, a gift in the amount of $150,000. Well done, good and faithful servant of God. Well done.
Thank you. That's fabulous. Woo. Well, that's a good way to start, Don. So, Roger, if you will, put up a couple of slides here. So that was a younger version of Don, although it's not significantly different than right now. He's aged really well.
I had hair.
You had a little hair. All right, let's go to the next one, Roger. And so this was the early elders, and you see Bob Mason and Al James there. Bob is sitting right here. Amen. And Chip Arnold's granddad, Walter Wyckoff's right there in the middle.
Oh, yeah, Chip
Phil Kendrick's dad, Bob Kendrick over there to the right. I mean, Paul Phillips. And so these were men who stuck around a long time and really helped get Belmont off the ground. Let's go to the next slide, Roger. And that's what it looked like probably in 71 by November or October.
November.
He came. Y'all know this is the exact date that he came in 1971, June 6, 1971, June 6, 2021, 50 years. And so, yeah, we've continued to crowd in.
I was already involved with these Jesus movement people, and so when I came over here, they started coming.
There you go. Exactly. And then we got so many, we went to West End. Anybody remember West End? Yeah. We had a great time there, and then go to the next one, Roger, and then 1988, we built the worship center here that y'all are in now, and God's been sovereign and blessing us all this time. So, Don, we have a plaque we want to give you this morning. It says, in 1971, you accepted the call from the Lord to serve as pastor of Belmont Church. And the rest is history.
Amen. I like it.
Blessings on you.
Thank you. Amen.
All right. Now you need to preach to us.
Well, I've been praying a lot and praying in the Spirit a lot. And that's all I knew how to do almost to prepare for today. I mean, what do you say after 50 years? Most of you have heard everything I've ever said or thought. But I felt like I felt that the only thing that I could do, I love this passage in 2 Peter 1, verses 12 and 13. And it says, I will always remind you of these things, even though you know them, and are firmly established in the truth you now have. And I think it's right to refresh your memory as long as I live in the present tent of this body. Now, I won't go ahead and continue because it says, because I know that I will soon put it aside as our Lord Jesus Christ has, has made clear to me, and I'll make every effort to see that after my departure, you'll always be able to remember these things. The Lord hadn't revealed to me that I'm about to put this body aside. And, you know, as long as I'm healthy, I'm glad to stay here. But we all know that it's better for us personally, Paul said that, to depart with the Lord. I really totally believe that. And so anyway, there are four basic things that I want to just rehearse with you, things that many of you, most of you in the room have heard me say similar things and some of the same things even over and over again. But one is, but they're the things that I see that were the most life-transforming things that happened to me. And they happened here. I mean, while I was still teaching Lipscomb in December of 69 is when I had that Holy Spirit experience, which really, I had no liquid love poured on me and all down. I didn't break out in speaking in tongues. But I settled once and for all that the Holy Spirit was active with all of its gifts, and I received it. And so I began to walk in it. That was while I was still teaching at Lipscomb. So we were talking about this Wednesday night. Bob Kendrick and Walter Wyckoff, I was preaching somewhere at Kentucky, and they went with me. And I told them that I believed in the Holy Spirit and all the gifts, and they didn't have any problem with it. But I even had a problem with it sometimes on how do you walk it out congregationally, you know. And so anyway, so the three things, J4, that's sort of biblical, you know, sounds like Proverbs. But the three things that I just want to highlight is, one is this, what I'm calling righteousness given. I think it's huge, and I'm pretty sure that there will be people in this room that still don't have that key down. And I want to just go through some scriptures of help, because Wednesday night, one of the ladies came up to me and said that she was afraid she wasn't saved, that I haven't done enough. It's not about doing enough. But anyway, we'll get to that. But anyway, righteousness given, and then just the whole thing of the fullness, Holy Spirit living, what I call Holy Spirit living. And then there's power in the name of Jesus. I want to talk about that a little bit. And then, J4, the thing that really drives me now to be here is, I mean, as most of you know, Todd and I just got back from northern Iraq, Kurdistan, a few days ago, because I still believe that Israel is coming to the Lord, Jewish people are coming to the Lord. I think it's biblical, and that what used to be Assyria and Egypt are going to come to the Lord, and they're going to be a blessing in the whole world. But I also know that Jesus said clearly in Matthew 24:14 that this gospel of the kingdom has to be preached to every ethnic group, and then the end will come. And so it has to go to it. We're getting closer to that ever. I still believe we're living in the end times of the end times, but we don't know how long that's going to be. I believe we're living in the season of the Lord's return. And that's why I keep saying that I think I could well see before I'm out of here the salvation of Israel. I think I could see a Jesus movement among the Jewish people like happened here. I do. I totally believe that. The Lord hadn't told me that I'm going to live to see it, but somehow I think that I might. And I, you know, I've told you, you know, you've heard, some of you heard me say that if I see that, then I'll be a Simeon. I'll go to the Lord and I'll say, you can let me go now. I saw it. But anyway, I just want to go on that. So let me just start off with this whole righteousness given. And let me start off by saying, some of you have, I wonder how many of you remember my mini outline of Romans 1 through 8. Do you remember my saying something about that? Well, let me just do it again. Romans 1, the world's in a mess. Romans 2, so are you. I mean, seriously, Romans 2, after you read all the horrors that people do, then Romans 2 says, well, why are you judging so? Because you're just like them. And I thought, no, I'm not. And then I thought, well, there's a seed form in me that if I started to go in that direction, I guess I could do just nearly anything, you know. But anyway, and then Romans 3, and that's what I want to get to. So Romans 3, verses 10 through 12. Look at this. I mean, I think it's comical the way Paul goes after this in Romans. It's like he's got a sledgehammer, and he's just hammering in a point. And look at this. As it is written, there is no one righteous. Okay, got it. Not even one. Okay. There is no one who understands. I got it the first time. There is no one who seeks God. Come on, you told me. All turned away. They've together become worthless. There's no one who does good, not even one. I mean, it's just over and over and over. You got it? In other words, that means there's not anybody in this room that's good. No one. Come on. If you think you deserve anything, the only thing you deserve is hell. Because you sinned enough to go to hell. And you can't do anything for it. And so that's just, but that's the first part of the gospel, but that's not the end of it. So anyway, and so then in Romans 3, verse 20, he says, no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin. But then in Romans 3, 21, he says, but now, this is when it gets good. I mean, it's amazing how many times I go back to Romans 3. If I do something stupid, or I'm disappointed in myself, or I think, yeah, I missed that, I go back to Romans 3. Oh, my God, I'm still righteous. How'd that happen? I'm not righteous, but you're making me righteous. So now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. This righteousness comes through faith to all who believe. Everyone who believes, God gives righteousness. He gives it. And so, I mean, I still remember, I love this illustration that E.B. Hill, I saw E.B. Hill do this one time, and thank God I've got a clean handkerchief so I can do it. But he did like this, he had the microphone like this, and he said, this is who you are in Jesus. You're covered with his righteousness. And so when God looks down at Ted, he sees righteousness. He sees you as a righteous person. This is your position in Jesus. That's your condition. That's who you are right now. But he takes, once you become a believer, he takes the rest of your life bringing your condition up to match your position. We become more righteous because we have been given righteousness. So then, I love Romans 4, verse 5. Get this. I love this verse. Romans 4, verse 5 says, God justifies the wicked. You can't get any worse than that. If there's somebody in here that feels like you've just done such stupidness that you can't be forgiven, you're not worse than wicked. And God justifies the wicked. Because in a sense, all of us are. And then, if you need that one, Romans 5, verse 17, the gift of righteousness. The gift of righteousness. But then, let me back up. In Romans 4, verses 7 and 8, when I read these verses, I didn't believe it. I thought it was a mistranslation. And I got every Bible I could to try to prove that these verses didn't say what they say. Listen to this. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Okay, I'm good with that. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. What? What? Blessed is the person whose sin the Lord won't ever count against him. That can't be right. You mean I can sin and it doesn't count? That's what it says. Well, let me get another translation. It says the same thing. Let me get another one. I looked through 5 or 10 Bibles to try to find a Bible that didn't say that. It says it. Well, I thought, oh my God. I mean, and then if my sin's not even counted, what's the big deal about sin? Uh-oh. So Paul comes back to Romans 6, verse 1, and he says, so shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? And it says, by no means, we died to sin. And so we don't want to sin. And what sin does, it breaks the relationship between you and God. When you sin, you get so disgusted with yourself. You know, I mentioned the other day, I think so often about, when I'm talking like this, about Jimmy Brewington, our neighborhood drunk back during the Jesus movement. And he was an alcoholic, and he was an almost hopeless alcoholic. But he came to the Lord, we baptized him, and he stayed sober for several days. And then he got drunk again, and he was. And so there's a passage in Romans 6 that says, talks about the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus and the law of sin and death. When we do something stupid and wake up to that stupidity and we're so disgusted, I mean, if somebody in this room, if you've been a drug addict and you go back and you use drugs and you're just so disgusted with yourself, don't kick into the law of sin and death, because what the law of sin and death is you get so disgusted with yourself that the only thing you know is go back and take some more drugs, you know. Or if you're an alcoholic or had an alcohol problem, and you can put your sin in there. That's just two that I'll put in there because I'm not guilty of them. And but anyway, if you have a problem with alcohol and then you get weak and you get drunk, well, no, I mean, what are you going to do? You're so disgusted, you have to drown your stuff in drink again. But if you kick into the law of spirit of life in Christ, it goes like this. You wake up from your drunkenness and you think, oh, that was horrible, that was horrible. My God, you still count me righteous? And so you don't drink for 2 years. You see what I'm saying? If you kick into the law of sin and of the spirit of life, your sin, when you get hold of it and realize you're still righteous, it makes you want to worship the Lord instead of go back and drink some more. And so that's the way to overcome sin, by doing those two things. So now, let me just pause right here. And say, and is there anybody in this room, I know there is, that really feel like if you died right now, you're not sure. You're not sure whether you'd go to the Lord or not. Well, have you come to the Lord? Have you acknowledged Him? Have you been baptized in the name of Jesus? Because He says you get forgiveness of sins, past, present, future, and the gift of the Holy Spirit. We'll talk about that. But if there's anybody in this room that not sure if you'd be saved because you're not good enough, come on, get off of it. It's not about being good enough. Because it'll make you praise God more when you realize it's not about being good enough. That He gives you His righteousness. And so is there anybody in this room who has committed your life to the Lord, you haven't been baptized, the baptistry's full. I mean, wouldn't it be wonderful if today 5, 10, 15 people just really, their lives were transformed and they never had a problem again about whether they were going to be saved or not? Wouldn't that be cool? I mean, there was a time when something like that happened to you. It did me. When I was baptized on the farm at age 11, I was so excited because all my juvenile sins were under the blood or in the water. And I remember hanging my clothes on the line at the farm. But by the bedtime, I'd already sinned. I'd thought something that wasn't good. And I was scared I'd go to hell if I died before I confessed it. And I woke up the next morning and I was afraid I'd, you know, when I got driver's license and all that kind of stuff, I'd try to get to the car and not think about anything negative before I got in the car, because if I died with any unconfessed sin, I'd go to hell. That's not the gospel. And if there's anybody in here that has that, get over it in Jesus' name. You know, I'm hesitating because I don't know. Let me just say it this way. If there's anybody here that I just described, then determine in your heart right now you're going to deal with that. And maybe when the prayer team comes up later, just come up and deal with it today. Because we need to all leave this place knowing all of us are redeemed through the blood of Jesus. Not because we're good, because we never get good enough, but because He's good and He gives it to us. Okay, the second thing is the fullness of the Holy Spirit. The other thing, I mean, it was transforming to me. Yes, I got, by faith, baptized in the Holy Spirit in December of 1969, when I was 39 years of age. And because all these Jesus people they had a radiance on their countenance and they had something I didn't have. They were assured of things, and they were walking in the fullness of the Holy Spirit. And so I got out with the Lord after the family had gone to bed, and I said, okay, Lord, that you and I pretend I've never read this. I'm going to read all these passages, and I'm going to believe them all. And that's the night I believed in the fullness of the Holy Spirit with all the gifts. And I said, I asked the Lord to baptize in the Holy Spirit, and I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit by faith. I didn't speak in tongues. But let me tell you something. You can be baptized in the Holy Spirit and not speak in tongues. Don't you? I dare you to find me a passage of Scripture that says tongues is the initial evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's just not there. Because if you receive the fullness of the Lord and His Holy Spirit, tongues may come, and if it does, praise God. And I'm glad. I think it's speed praying. And I just break out in it sometimes and don't even know I'm doing it. But if in those 2 years when I didn't have it, I didn't feel like a second-class citizen. I just walked around, and I was having other experiences where I knew God was there. I had words of knowledge and words of wisdom, and I'd start praying for somebody, and they'd fall out in the Spirit. I had all kinds of experiences. I knew God was working in me, but I didn't speak in tongues yet. But I just want to say, we receive. Okay, let's go to Acts 2:38. Good passage of Scripture. Look at it. You know this one. Peter, when they cried out on the day of Pentecost and said, "What shall we do?" Peter says, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Okay, first of all, let me tell you that baptism is a new word in the Christian vocabulary, but it wasn't a new thought in Jewish thought. The word is a new thought, but they went through ceremonial washings all the time. Men went and women went through. So the only thing that's different about this ceremonial washing, this mikvah, which is baptism, on the day of Pentecost, is for the first time in history, you can go through a ritual cleansing in the name of somebody who actually takes your sin. That was the only difference. And so that's what happens now. But look, but when we are baptized in the name of Jesus, we get two things. We get forgiveness of sins forever, rest of our lives, and we get the Holy Spirit, the thing that they got on Pentecost. So it's ours. Now, in my case, what I felt like I did was, that night in 69, I felt like, oh, I got it. When I got baptized, I got two things, but I left one of them on the shelf. You know, it's like I told you the other night, like going to the store and buying two books, and then you walk out with one of them. Oh, I've got to go back and get that book. It's already paid for. So I said, oh, I just got forgiveness of sins, but I didn't get the Holy Spirit. All right, let's get the confidence of the Holy Spirit. And so if that's who you are, just go back and pick up that other book. Just go back and pick up the Holy Spirit and start walking in it. And so that's what happened to me. And I made the deal with the Lord. Many of you know this. I made the deal with the Lord. Oh, now I know you've been talking to me, but I didn't know it was you. So now when I hear anything that's unquestionably good and can't be bad, then if you'll give me the energy, I don't care what it is, I'll do it. And I realized that all that junk that was in my head because of childhood junk, the devil was throwing it into my head and then accusing me of it. So I said, now from this point forward, if I hear anything that's unquestionably evil and can't possibly be good, then I'm going to say, go back to hell where you belong. That's not mine. And you know what? That's the way I've lived since December 69. I'm still living that way. I'm still wanting to hear God. The latest kind of thing the Lord's saying to me is, you know, we had that passage over here, and by the way, it's over there somewhere, John 14:12, that anyone who believes on me, we had it posted over here for years when I was the last years of I was here. Anyone who believes on me will do the things I'm doing. So that's a challenge in my lifetime. Jesus said he only did what saw the Father doing. He only said what he heard the Father saying. That's what I want to do. I just want to do what he's doing and say what he's saying. And so that's how I'm stirring. Do I always do it? Of course not. But we're in perfection down here, but we do the best we know how to do. So one of the passages then that in this was John 8:47 that let me know that I was hearing from God. And John 8:47 says that those who belong to God hear what God says. Well, I belong to him. And so, I've said this from this pulpit, I'm sure, before, but if there's anybody in the room who says, well, I just don't hear God, I would say, yes, you do. How do you know what I do and what I don't? Because I believe the Word of God more than I believe you. And if you're a believer, you hear from God. I do? Yeah, you do. Pay attention. I love that passage in Matthew 16, review, where Peter says, you're the Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus says, flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. And I want to put a byline there from Peter. It didn't? You mean I didn't think of that? No, Peter, you weren't even smart enough to think of that. No. God revealed it. He did? I felt like I thought of it. Pay attention, Peter. That's the way God talks. Okay. And then a few minutes later, Jesus said he was going to be crucified. Peter pulls him aside, even though he just told him he's the Messiah. He pulls him aside and rebukes him for saying that he's going to be killed. And Jesus turns to him and says, "Get up behind me, Satan." Lord, you were looking at me when you said that. I know, because you were speaking the words of the enemy. I was? Pay attention, Peter. That's the way the enemy talks. So anyway, that's just, I mean, I like living this way. And then Romans 8:6, how many times have I spoken that from this passage, from this pulpit? The mind governed by the spirit is, let's see how that went. The mind governed by the flesh is death. The mind governed by the spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the spirit is life and peace. And one day, I'm a long time ago, but one day the Lord said, you're trying to walk in the spirit controlled by the mind. Get that reversed. Walk in your mind controlled by the spirit. And then another one in 1 Corinthians 14:1, that one was challenging to me. See, this is why I would say, follow the way of love and eagerly desire gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. See, I was thinking this morning, it didn't say desire earnestly the gifts of the Spirit, especially tongues. Could have. Prophecy. Well, what's prophecy? Prophecy's encouraging people. Are you encouraging somebody? Are you looking into somebody and seeing more than they see themselves and you're telling about? That's prophecy. Now, there are all kinds of prophecy, but that's one of the ways we prophesy. And so, I mean, you remember Paul saying that he wishes everybody spoke in tongues? Well, I wish everybody prophesied too. We're supposed to. So if you don't think you prophesy, come on, get over it. I mean, get your mind off yourself and over to somebody else. And get your mind on what you might be saying or doing or encouraging somebody. Write those encouraging notes and do those encouraging things. And by the way, I was just remembering because of somebody that's here in the room that after I'd had that night, and I woke up one morning at 2:30 and I was writing notes of encouragement to people, and one of them is in the room that I wrote a note to that night. We were talking about it a while ago. When I told him that I wrote a note and said, I pray you're miserable until you turn your life back to the Lord. I love you. And it worked. So now, the other thing that I want to say is, I just want us to think about, there's power in the name of Jesus. He is Lord. He is God. He is Christ. But there are other lords, there are other gods, there are other Christs. But the power is not in the name of God. You don't pray in the name of God. There's no scripture that says pray in the name of God. That's not a name anyway. You don't pray in the name of Christ. You name him. You pray the name Jesus. And I just wanted to go through some of the Acts 3, verse 6. Peter said, silver and gold I don't have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus, walk. He didn't say the name of God. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, because that's where the power came to earth. And then in 3:12 of Acts, men of Israel, why does this surprise you at this man? Why do you stare at us as though through our own power or godliness we made this man walk? No. 16, by faith in the name of Jesus, this man that you see and know is made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that's completely healed him, as you can see this day. And then in Colossians 3:17, whatever you do in word or deed, you do it all in the name of Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Or Philippians, the second chapter, and I may not even go through the whole thing, but your attitude should be that's in Christ Jesus. Have this same mindset. Jesus didn't consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the nature of servant, being in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man, humbled himself, became obedient to death. God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that in the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus the Messiah is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The elevation of the name of Jesus. And then Jesus says over and over again in such passages as John 14, I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name and I'll do it. Or John 15, 16, the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. And so there's power in the name of Jesus. Now, you know, I don't expect, no, I think we ought to expect things. When you pray for somebody, just realize, I mean, don't think about yourself when you start praying for somebody. When you put your hands on them, think about Him. The power is in Him. The healing power is in Him. And yes, there have been healing, and there may be healing. And if you need healing this morning, you come down and let prayer team and or let people around you that you trust pray for you. Don't leave her out there. Come up here and get some oil if you need it. By the way, the first time we had somebody come forward to pray, and we didn't, back in the old building, we didn't have any oil up front. So Bob Kendrick went back and found some 3-in-1 oil and used it. I thought that was pretty cool, 3-in-1. I kind of wanted to have that the rest of my life. 3-in-1, that's good. So anyway, but I just want to, I mean, let me just tell you a couple of things that happened to me while I was here with you. One of the first couple of years that I was here, we had a couple who were engaged, about to be married, and she'd had a very turbulent life, very godless life. He had too, and they were engaged now, but they were out driving one night, and she became catatonic. She just froze. She couldn't talk. So he called me and said, can we come over and pray? So they came over to my house and pray, and she just sat there. Her eyes were glazed, everything. And the Lord gave me the vision of the Battle of Ai, when there was an ambush over here and then the people went in. And so I saw that she has the Holy Spirit in her because she was a believer. But she was catatonic, but she's got the Holy Spirit living in her. And then there's the Holy Spirit that can be poured out on her. So I started appealing to the Holy Spirit inside of her. And I started calling her name and just say, now, in your spirit, cry out the name of Jesus. And you couldn't see anything happening to her, except we just went after that for a while. And then I said, now bring that to your soul, your mind, your will, your emotion. Scream the name of Jesus inside with your soul. And we went after that for a while. And then I said, okay, now, and I called her by name, and I said, now bring that to your body and start confessing the name of Jesus. And you could see her go, you know, start wiggling her lips a little bit and then sort of mumbling a little bit. And then she started barely saying Jesus. And then she started saying it a little louder. And then she started, and then finally she's really saying it. And then I started praying that God would baptize her fresh in His Holy Spirit. And then we all broke out in, and we were holy rollers that night. We were laughing and rolling across the floor. And that's the first time actually I ever spoke in tongues. I all of a sudden I realized, oh, you're talking something. You're not talking English. What is this? Anyway, but there was a power. There was another night. I got called in the middle of the night, and there was a lady whose husband was a veteran, and he would come home drunk sometime, and she'd never been afraid of him. But on this night, she was really getting afraid, and she basically said, could you come over? Well, I don't come by myself in a situation like that, so I called one of our men, and we met, and we went over to their house, and the guy came out when I came to the house and just acted sober, and he said, oh, I'm sorry, Donna, you had to come over, and really, we're okay. And anyway, I walked in the room, and then I put my hand on, and when I started praying in the name of Jesus, he came at me and came this close to me, he's a man I didn't want to tangle with. But the Holy Spirit came on me. He had his hands just like this, this close to my throat. I called him my name, said, you can't touch me. I'm covered by the blood of Jesus. He fell unconscious at my feet. Yeah, that happened 3 times that night. So I'm just telling you, there's power in the name of Jesus. I don't know if any of you remember the story of Brother Yun, the heavenly man. His mother had become a believer when the Chinese missionaries were there. And then they were all out. And her husband, one of her sons had died of starvation. And her husband was now dying. And she remembered, she'd hadn't been walking in the faith, but she remembered that there was power in the name of Jesus. And so she called, got all of her kids out of bed, had them around their father, and she started to say, "Now just call on Jesus." They didn't have a clue who Jesus was. But he just said, so they all started calling on Jesus, and he was recovered. And then they had a house church. She couldn't even read. She had to have people telling her what the Bible said. I won't go into that whole thing. Now that I said it, I will. But anyway, it was so funny. She thought the missionaries had said, she thought they were saying Holy Dragon instead of Holy Spirit. So she was asking people to call on the Holy Dragon, too. And when the brother Young started reading, he said, "Mom, it's not Holy Dragon, it's Holy Spirit." Oh, so they had to tell everybody, "No, it's not Holy Dragon." Anyway, Brother Young said, "You can be wrong about a lot of things, you can't be wrong about Jesus." So anyway, there are all kinds of stuff like that. Andrew White, when he was down, the vicar of Baghdad, told about a father whose daughter was dying in a hospital in Baghdad. And he told him, just call Jesus all the way to the hospital. And they got there, already pulled the sheet over her head. He just kept saying, "Jesus, Jesus." The daughter finally pushed the sheet back and said, "She's hungry. Raised from the dead." I'm just saying, there's power in the name of Jesus, and it's ours to be there to do that. All right, so call upon his name, pray in the name of Jesus, lift up his name, worship him. I'm so glad that, Michael, that in worship we were calling on Jesus' name. I love it when we can sing the psalms, but let's always remember that our path to God is through Jesus. And the other thing, I won't take a lot of time on this one, but I still remember a sermon that Reuben Duran preached while we were at West End Junior High. And I can't remember anything that I preached. I do remember that when I preached in December here, because I preached on the guaranteed path to joy, peace, and optimism. And then I got diagnosed with COVID the next day, and I wasn't joyful nor peaceful nor optimistic. So I remember that. But anyway, Reuben had... He preached on him. He called a message called "The Three Untils," and I've never forgotten it. And so let me just go to those. One of those untils is in Isaiah, the 6th chapter, verse 11, where God, Isaiah hears a voice, "Whom shall I send?" He says, "Send me." And God says, "Go tell Israel that her eyes are going to be closed and her heart hardened." And Isaiah says, "How long?" And the answer is, until the cities lie ruined and without inhabitant, until the houses are left deserted and the fields ruined and ravaged, until the Lord has sent everyone far away and the land is utterly forsaken. That's how long Israel's eyes are going to be closed. Now, this is the reason why I believe Israel's supposed to come to the Lord now, because the land is no longer forsaken. It's no longer devastated. The houses are no longer ruined. That's why we're having some degree of revival among Jewish people in our day like never before, like in all the history. But it's got to be more. So join me in praying that. The next one is Luke, the 21st chapter, verse 24, when God told, Jesus said that Jerusalem would fall by the sword, would be taken prisoners to all the nations, and Jerusalem will be trampled on by Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. Jerusalem was trampled on by Gentiles. Even when they became a nation in 1948, they didn't take Jerusalem. But in 1967, in the Six-Day War, they took Jerusalem. I believe the time of the Gentiles was over, because the early church was Jewish. Totally. No Gentiles in the early part. Then it became Jew-Gentile. Then, for 18 centuries, it was a Gentile church. Jewish people that came to faith joined the Gentile church, and their generations became Gentiles. Because the church and the synagogue both said, when you become a Christian, you're no longer a Jew. That's a lie, but that's what people believed. But now, the Jews are back. We're in a Jew-Gentile time. And so there is it's the time for the revival among the Jews and among the Gentiles. So I thank you. I just thank you, Lord, for the revival that you're bringing in our day. And I pray that we'll continue to experience it. Now, the other until is Romans 11, chapter verse 25. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the fullness of the Gentiles comes. So again, I think it's referring to when they took Jerusalem in 1967. So one of the things that stirs me now is the urgency of the times in which we're living. So I want all of us to know that we're redeemed, to know that we have the Holy Spirit, to pray and prophesy and live in the authority and in the name of Jesus, and to live with excitement that in spite of all the horror news, and don't watch too much news, it is not going to be very edifying. And if you watch too much news, I mean, maybe watch enough to know what's going on and then turn the thing off and pray. And spend more time in the Bible than you do in front of the TV, or in time in praying. Go for walks with the Lord. He wants to walk with you. He wants to be with us. And then may it be, Lord, that the people that are right here in this room right now, and most of them have been believers for many years, may we be so radically full of the Holy Spirit that this group right here becomes a transforming power in this city, in this state, in the nation, and in the world, to the glory of God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Stay up here. So we've been sufficiently challenged today. If you have prayer needs, we're going to have our prayer team over here. And I thought a great way for us to end today, we'll go ahead and have the worship team come up. Don is going to pronounce the Aaronic blessing over us, which we will receive. And then we're going to sing the song, The Blessing. I love it because it talks about from a thousand generations. So it's not just about what happened 50 years ago. It's about what God is doing moving forward and wants us to be part of it. So, amen. So, Don?
You're doing it now? You're doing it. You'll do it now? Shall I do it now? You tell them.
Don has a request.
Michael called me and said he might do this. It's so interesting. I pulled this out the other day and rehearsed the lyrics. And so before we do anything else, everybody stand up and I'll just go for it. I danced in the morning when the world was begun, danced on the moon and the stars and the sun. I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I'll lead you all, wherever you may be. For I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance and they would not follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John, and they came with me, and the dance goes on. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I'll lead you all, wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath when the sky turned black. Hard to dance with the Holy Spirit back. Wait a minute. I danced on the Sabbath and I cured the lame. The holy people thought it was a shame. They whipped me and they stripped me and they hung me high. Left me there on the cross to die. But dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I'll lead you all in the river you may be. Lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone. But I rose again and the dance goes on. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I'll lead you all, wherever you may be. For I'm the Lord of the dance, said he. They cut me down, but I leaped up high. I am the Lord that'll never, never die. I live in you if you live in me. For I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Blessed then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I'll lead you on wherever you may be. Yes, I am the Lord of the dance, said he. So from the ridiculous to the sublime. Oh, all of you, remember, there is one blessing in Scripture that God worded himself. And the only one that God actually worded and he gave to Moses to give to Aaron, with which to bless all future generations of Israel. But since we are all grafted into Israel, it belongs to us as well. And so, and God says, when you do it, I'll put my name on them. So I'll say it in English first, and you just grab it, and then in Hebrew. Give it a, oh, the Lord bless you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Yivarechacha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai panav alecha v'chonecha. Yisa Adonai panav alecha v'yisim lecha shalom. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach Sal Shalom. In the name of Jesus, the Messiah, Prince of Peace. Amen. Let's sing it. Sing it. Are you doing it? Yeah.
Children and their children, may his favor be upon. upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children.
If anyone needs prayer, we have our prayer team available over here. I think in light of the message, I think that would be more than applicable to let's pray. Let's have baptisms. Let's have salvation. Let's have all of that in the name of Jesus right now. If you don't know the Lord, come forward. We'll pray for you right now. If you've never been baptized, come forward. The baptistry's full, right? There's water up there, right? Okay. We'll get some water. We have bottled water.
Again, thank you for being here this morning. We have nibbles, and we would love for you to just spend time fellowshipping with each other. What a marvelous morning in the Lord. One more hand for the Lord and his work in us. So thank you for being here. We do bless and honor Jesus today. Thank you so much. Amen.